Wait. Thank you. 问他交流啊！你看，communication叫comrade，叫交流，大点声，胆子大，不要脸就行了。我就这，我听不懂，我一点都听不懂。
Good afternoon. Hello, everyone. This afternoon, we will invite Professor O’Connor. He will give us a speech The title is On the Management of the Gangue Minerals in Flotation of Platinum Group Minerals. Let's welcome Professor O’Connor.
Maybe this one.
Let's put this back in again. Sorry, I thought this was loaded already.
This one.
So, Professor Weisson, Shishien, thank you very much for your kind introduction. So now we start our workshop, and I'm going to ask my colleague Belinda to help me a bit here and there, because quite a few of the slides she's got more knowledge on than I have. But I mentioned this morning that one of the most important things that we should be doing in flotation is to manage the gangue mineral. And Belinda this morning showed some slides about entrainment, true flotation, and so on. So this is a summary of about 10 years of research on managing the behavior of the gangue minerals, particularly in platinum group mineral flotation. On managing the behavior of the gangue minerals, particularly in platinum group mineral flotation. Right, so as the slide says, in the time of decreasing head grades, one of the major challenges is to manage the behavior of gangue minerals. So I'm going to talk through the slide, then you can translate. So in the treatment of platinum group minerals, this is even more important. And the reason is very simple. Firstly, platinum group minerals are very important in South Africa. South Africa produces 80 to 90% of the world's platinum. And interestingly enough, platinum prices are down at the moment. $800 an ounce, it was $1,900 about 10, 15 years ago. But the palladium prices are up. And an interesting point is, with the reduced production of diesel motor cars, diesel engine motor prices are, the requirement for platinum in catalysts, auto catalysts, is reduced. But the palladium is very good for diesel or for petrol driven cars. So a lot of the price arrangements here depends on the automobile industry around the world. The second interesting point, and Belinda will remember, we've got an adjunct professor in our center who was a top man in one of the platinum companies. The big automobile manufacturers around the world have stockpiled platinum. So companies like Nissan, Toyota, Mercedes, BMW, they've got large reserves of platinum. And so the prices of platinum are down. But anyway, it's a very important industry. You can see in the north of the country, there's about 800 years of the global platinum. So we've got a lot of platinum. But the head grades are about 3 to 4 ppm. And so you compare that to copper mining. If you're mining copper, and you've got a head grade of 0.5%, which is round about what Chile has today, you're talking of 5,000 ppm. So you can see 4 ppm compared to 5,000 ppm. Most of the platinum mineral being floated is gangue. So it's only four particles in every million that you're trying to recover. So there's 1 million minus four gangue particles. So it's all about gangue management. And you can see here, if you're upgrading from 4 to 100 ppm, that means to say that you've got about 80% of all the oil coming in. You'll need to depress about 98% of the gangue minerals. So of every 100 particles entering your flotation plant, 98 of them must be depressed. So flotation in PGM is about gangue management.
Rotation in PGM is about gangue management.
另外就是它的这个金铂族金属的储量可以延续到八百年，就在全球可以延续到八百年。另外是比如说这个铂族金属的含量大概是3到4克吨的样子，大部分都是脉石矿物。这个低品位的铜矿的含量大概是零点五左右，也就是说
We'll be running a flotation circuit. The flotation cell, you only have three parameters that you can control. You can control the reagent type that you're using and the reagent dosage. You can control the froth depth and you can control the air addition rate. Obviously, we're assuming that you have bought this flotation cell from Metso or Autotech. So you've got this flotation cell. Those are the only three operating parameters that you've got available. There are many other variables, such as the feed rate, particle size distribution, and head grade. But you can't control those. They've been determined upstream. So this morning I was talking to you about integrating comminution and flotation, and this is obviously feed rate is dependent on how much oil you're bringing in. But if you've got a very large mill, the feed rate would be quite high. In fact, the reason why so many flotation cells today are so big, the biggest flotation cells in the world at the moment are about 600 to 700 cubic meters. Those are very big. And the reason why they've got so big is that the mills have become very big. So the amount of ore going through the circuit has become very large. So, but these variables, you cannot control. You cannot control head grade. You decided to buy this mine, and that's what you've got available. So those are not control parameters. So in this talk, I'm going to speak mainly about selection of reagent type and dosage as a critical parameter. We'll also show that froth depth can play an important role in managing gangue, and air addition rate, I'm not going to speak much about it yet, right at the end. Right, so the outline of the talk is shown on this slide. I'm first of all going to talk a little bit about the mineralogy of the ore that we study. Then we're going to, and this built from Belinda this morning, talking about CMC versus guar. Then we're going to talk about the effect that depressions have on froth behavior. And this is a very important point, that the depression not only depresses the particles, but it affects the froth in the secondary effect. We'll talk about the interaction between collectors and depressants. Belinda this morning mentioned we're doing a lot of work in our research center on the effect of processed water. And we'll look at how different quality of processed water affects the behavior of the depressant. And then finally, we're going to talk about chromite. Chromite is a gangue in PGM. But nowadays, chromite prices are so good that it's actually a desirable product. And we'll talk about chromite right at the end. Madam. Is a gangue in PGMs. But nowadays, chromite prices are so good that it's actually a desirable product. And we'll talk about chromite right at the end.
对比 CMC 和就是 CMC 和古尔胶的这两种抑制剂，然后是这种抑制剂对泡沫行为的影响，还有就是抑制剂跟捕收器之间的作用，
协同作用，
协同作用。另外是就是浮选用水里面的这种盐离子对这种脉石矿物的行为的影响。另外就是亚铬酸盐，
隔铁矿，
对，另外就是隔铁矿，在隔铁矿的控制，就是
最主要的这种脉石矿物。
对，最主要的脉石矿物是隔铁矿的，它可能以前是脉石矿物，以后可能会越来越有用。
So I was interested. I think you were thinking about that word there.
Yes.
Because when I talk to people who don't know anything about minerals processing,
they ask you, what is that word? Even English-speaking people, gangue, sometimes people call it gangue, called gang.
Yes.
This is the base for the mineral precision.
We want?
This is the base for the mineral precision. Yeah, yes, please. But hi, from my experience. So,
these are pyroxene salts. And very little chroma, the blackest chroma. The UG2 reef contains a lot of chroma and less or a pyroxene. And then the Platt reef, which is the one which is mainly being exploited at the moment, where there's a lot of reserves, has got quite a lot of pyroxene. So the gang minerals are all these minerals here that we are referring to. I should just mention the little red line there is the base metal sulfides, copper, lead, zinc, copper and nickel and pentlandite, copper pyrite. And there's a lot of platinum in those base metal sulfides. And one of the points that I'm going to talk about, or we're going to talk about in the next day or two, this ore here, we were talking about it this morning, the operations treat this ore as if it's a sulfide. But there's hardly any sulfides there. It's all tellurides and arsenides. And that's why we want to develop reagents that will recover the tellurides and arsenides. Whereas here there's a lot of that's relatively quite a lot of sulfur. So that's the mineralogy, and you can see that there's a lot of chromite. We don't want the chromite. Why don't we want the chromite? Because if the chromite's in the concentrate, it creates problems in the smelter. If there's more than about 5%, Belinda, 3% chromite in the concentrate, you get problems in the smelter. So we've got to depress the chromite. So that's an example of how to manage the gangue minerals, and it's so critical to do that properly. This is an interesting slide, and Belinda spoke about it this morning, about talc rimming. So here's an example of a little bit of talc on a particle, and Belinda spoke about pyroxene. Pyroxene is a gangue mineral, and it should not be naturally floatable, but it does float. And the reason why it floats is because a little bit of talc around the particle, and talc is very hydrophobic, the talc makes the particle report to the concentrate. So this is an example of what Belinda spoke about this morning of talc rimming. And this is, I think, the lady from Kunming, we're talking about the pen pan, how difficult, very difficult to pick up that talc rimming. But it's very important because it makes the particle behave totally differently. So this little bit of talc rimming around there suddenly makes the particle naturally floatable. And then, of course, we've got chromite. There's an example of a chromite particle. So this is just an example from the Moretsky reef of how gangue minerals, and this, I think this also explains or illustrates the importance of process mineralogy, MLA, Quem scan, to improve our understanding of the ore that we're trying to treat.
Mm-hmm.
illustrates the importance of processed mineralogy, MLA, Quem scan, to improve our understanding of the ore that we're trying to treat.
就是在这种Moriskin这种岩石的矿物里发现，就是这个滑石，它是有轻微的罩盖在这个斜方灰石还有这个硫化矿物的表面，它比那种罩盖还更小， 就是rim， 就是很少很少量的一点点，
边缘上有一点点，然后又在其他的矿物上就发现还有一些这种个铁矿。简单来说，就是它开埠的关系比较复杂，所以要先用MRA或者Quinscan来去发现它的一些细节的一些信息。因为Quinscan也是选矿和是眼睛的眼睛。
Let's look at the CMC versus guar. Now this morning, Belinda showed a slide like this, and it took me illustrates again. Guar, these are both polysaccharides, and guar is a neutral molecule, and CMC has got a charge down, and that's what we call the degree of substitution, or what the degree of substitution illustrates. And so I think we heard this morning, in used as a mainstream depressant for the depressant of gangue minerals in the treatment of platinum group ores.
这个古尔肖和CMC刚才有相同的单统的这个结构的单元，然后它们主要是由一个关于化学的这个质量矿物在不同的组织当中起到完全不同的作用。
I'm so glad you've got some assistance now, because I was scared that by the end of today you're going to be totally exhausted. And she's here. Right. Okay. So, this is a slide which Belinda also showed in a different form this morning. This is the story of This is the story of looking at the difference between naturally floating gangue and entrained gangue. So what we see here, this is the amount of gangue that's floating, and this is in grams. You can see grams of gangue floating versus grams of water. And the point I want to just illustrate, first here, obviously, this is with no depressant, and this is with 300 grams per ton, which is round about what they're using in industry, 300, 400 grams per ton. And you can see all the naturally floating gangue has been depressed, which is what it should be. But what is interesting is look at how the amount of water that's recovered has decreased. That's the water recovered when you've got no depressant, and that's the water recovered when you've got depressant. So if you're recovering less water, that means to say that your froth is less stable. Because if your froth is stable, there's going to be a lot of water coming over. If the froth is collapsing, you won't recover so much water. So the amount of water recovered is a good illustration of the stability of the froth. Now, why is the froth less stable? And the froth is less stable because you've got fewer solid particles in the froth. And the solid particles will stabilize the froth. But if you're depressing them, because that's what depression does, you've got less solids reporting. You can see now, you've got, in this case, only a few grams of solids. Now you've got 30, 40 grams of solids. So you've taken almost 80% of the solids out of the froth. This is a batch experiment, which is different to a plant, but the story is consistent. And so this results in a less stable froth. So this is a good example of the operator on the plant having to be careful to optimize the reagent condition, because you've got a less stable froth, and the danger here is that you're going to recover less of the valuable minerals. So you've managed the gangue very well, but you could have resulted in an unstable froth
which results in less platinum group minerals being recovered. So this is an unintended consequence of adding the pressure.
这是个比较关注的，比较了解，像这种不添加抑制剂的话，这个水的回收率特别高，然后这个慢释放的回收率也特别高。但是加了抑制剂，把这个水的回收率降低了，然后慢释放的回收率也会降低，那么水的回收率降低了，就说明这个泡沫的稳定性会下降，因为没有水分越来越少。但是如果说水过少的话，
所以，这是个 good example. You're doing a PhD on depression, and you publish a very nice paper showing how your depression has resulted in much less gangue being recovered. But what you forgot about, by doing that, you reduced the recovery of platinum. So when we did this, this is a long story over 10, 15 years. When we did this research at first, that's what we published. But as we started to understand frost more, and Belinda's going to talk much more about frost later, start realizing that actually you've destabilized the frost. So what are you going to do about that? That comes up in the next slide. I think we can move on. Well, this simply illustrates the same story again. And what we're looking at is liberated particles. This is with depression, or this is with no depression. These are particles in the 38 to 75 fraction of orthopyroxene. And you can see here that with no depression, the mass of orthopyroxene in the concentrate very high. These are particles in different size classes. You're recovering a lot of these liberated particles, and here we show that when you add depression, you're depressing them all, which is exactly what we're trying to do. But again, I say, you've now reduced the number of solid particles in the froth, and you've destabilized the froth, which is a bad thing.
接下来这个例子就是说，如果用了抑制剂的话，它的这个白色的柱状的它的这个量会下来，就是说它还是会抑制这个有用矿的这个回收，就是说整体的这个。
Right, the second point that we were talking about here was comparing WAR and CMC, and I'm not going to spend too much time on this slide, but suffice to say, this is the amount of floating gangue recovered against water recovered, and no depression, we've seen this before, a lot of water recovered and a lot of solid recovered, obviously. 100 grams per ton, you can see WAR is actually a slightly better depressant than CMC. But we heard this morning from the chap who was sitting over there, the cell phone and talk with an urgent message. There he is there. He told us this morning that in fact you are using CMC, which makes a lot of sense. And we agree with that. But when you get to dosages of about 300 grams per ton down here, they behave the same. So guar is not a better depressant necessarily than CMC. So CMC is a good idea. We agree with that, and so that's the new CMC.
Belinda, can you just talk to the slide?
Yes.
Do you want to point that out?
So what we were doing, what we were doing in this study was trying to see whether a high or low molecular weight was preferentially absorbed when you absorb onto top. So what you're doing is, this is the black line is what's there, this is the molecular weight, and that's what's there in the feed, and that's what's there in the residual, that's what was actually absorbed. So basically it's quite a complicated graph, but what it's showing is that the lower molecular weight was preferentially absorbed. So you know that bars and CMCs, they're not one chain length. You don't just get one chain length. There's a range of different chain lengths, from small to large. And it's the smaller ones that are preferentially absorbed.
Is it better to chop it up into smaller pieces of 100,000? And so I think that was some of the. So this was done with a company that manufactures CMC because they can hydrocrack these into smaller pieces.
goals to understand.
On the CMC, and if you get to certain levels where I don't think you can actually resolve the problem.
Forms a gel.
So in terms of concentration of the CMC, you get water of hydration through hydrogen bonding, and then it gels. And I think even in industry, I think we heard from our environment friends, or somebody else, that yeah, at a certain percentage of addition, it doesn't dissolve properly, forms a gel. I don't know if, but I mean that's hydrogen bonding with the water.
You're talking about
a
coil into basically a round mass.
Yeah, that's
the same
photo that
I showed earlier. Actually, shows it
evolving around four. So it's quite complicated. Okay, thank you. Right. So now, here's an important point. So you are running this plant, and you have decided to add CMC to depress the gangue. And you've added 300 grams per ton, which is not too bad. And now you have succeeded in depressing the gangue, but you've also reduced recovery of the PGMs because your froth is less stable. So what you can do, you decide, well, I'm going to add more frother, which is not necessarily a cheap option. So you've already paid for the depressor. Now you're going to pay for more frother. So let's look at trying to compensate. So this is a very busy slide. Let's remember what we're trying to do. Now we have no depression. And this is water recovered versus frother dosage. So here we've got no depression, and we've got 40 grams per ton of frother, 50 grams per ton, 60, 70. As you add more frother, we are collecting more solids, and we are collecting more water. Because when you're adding more frother, your froth is becoming more stable. Okay? Now what happens, we add our depressor. And as we saw in the previous slide, you've added the depressor, but look what's happened to your water and solid recovery. It's gone from this level at 40 grams per ton, from 800 grams of water to 200 grams of water. So you have seriously destabilized your froth. And how do I know that? Because water recovery is an indication of froth stability. So now you tell your operator, because you're the metallurgical superintendent, put more froth in. So they put more froth in, they go up to 70 grams per ton, and now it's starting to do its job. We know that. It's starting to increase the water recovery, increase the solid recovery. And if we are working at, let's leave the guar story out, if we are working at 500 grams per ton, you actually have just about the same effect. So the moral of the story, the take-home message here, is that you can compensate for the froth stability, the instability, by adding more froth. The only question now to think about is dollars or yuan. How much are you paying for your reagent? Because you've just bought a whole lot of CMC and you've used it. Now you're going to go and buy more froth to get the froth stable again. So it's an interesting story, and Belinda's going to give a talk on interactive effects between reagents. So here is a good example of an interactive effect between a depressant doing its job but lowering the cost stability, and meaning you're going to have to add more profit. So you're going to have to pay more money for your profit. And so it's a very interesting example of interaction between reagents.
水的回收率特别高，然后这个矿的回收率也是特别高，就前面那个最高的例子，然后第二呢就是加了CMC的时候，然后它的这个水的回收率下来了，但是这个矿的这个回收率下来了。第三呢就是说如果把这个抑制剂用量加大，然后这个发现这个
它的这个水的回收率从免费店儿差不多，但是它是有用的这个矿物的这个容量还是相对来说会少一点，就说明说你这个抑制剂不能就是加太多的话，它会把这个矿物就是矿物电不稳定，然后不稳定以后水的回收率就下来，水的回收率降低以后，它的这个整体这个矿物里面这个
就说明说你这个抑制剂不能。
This opportunity to pay recognition to one of my former colleagues, Professor Peter Harris. He's now retired, but Peter knows more about depressions than I'll ever learn my whole life. He was the godfather of depressions worldwide, probably, and he retired from what was the National Institute of Mentality, now called MINTEC, came to work with us, and he was the person who started telling us to plot water, to measure water recovery and solid recovery. It took me a long time, but I'm a bit dumb, to understand how important it is to measure water recovery and solid recovery, because it taught me so much about what's happening in the flotation cell. So I think that's an important take-home message also, which Peter Harris taught us, water and solid recovery in your flotation studies.
那个 Professor Thomas 就是强调这个 water 跟就水的回收率和这个矿物回收率的重要性，就是说你们这个水的回收率是跟这个矿物回收率是成正比的关系的，你们水的回收率越高，你们水越多的话，就矿物越多，它上面那个矿物的这个回收率就越高。反过来就是说矿物回收率，就是这个它是和这个矿物的稳定性是适合的。
I should also pay tribute to our colleague Jenny Visa, who's also retired now. She did so much of this work in the last 10, 15 years, and now we have a chance to understand what the message was. Right, so now we are talking a little bit about the interaction between collectors and depressants, and I'm not going to spend too much time on this slide. This was looking at the validities of different CMCs. The depriment, I think they were.
They're different. Degree of substitution, I think.
No. The point of this slide was that these were different CMCs of different degrees of substitution. And what we're looking at here is the difference between sodium ethyl xanthate and sodium isobutyl xanthate. Again, water solids recovery. And so you can see that with the SIBX, we always get less solids and less water than with the SEX. So this is an interaction between the xanthate and the depressant. But Linda, what is happening? We don't know.
I think the hydrophobicity's gone over
a peak. That's it. Linda showed a plot this morning of contact angle going like that, and that was a function of
the proximity.
Yeah, proximity. So this is a very important measure. The froth is most stable when the particles in the froth are of moderate hydrophobicity. I don't know what moderate means. And I asked Graham Jamison a month ago in Denver, Colorado, what does moderate mean? And he said, I'm not so sure either. He's the person, the guru who, so it means if you've got very hydrophobic particles, your froth becomes unstable. If you've got only slightly hydrophobic particles, your froth is unstable. There's an optimum. Belinda showed that plot this morning. And I think what Belinda's saying is that with respect to the SIBX, you have increased, you've gone over that peak. So your particles are now too hydrophobic, and so your froth becomes unstable, which is why we get less water and less solids. So the main message for translation is that when your particles are too hydrophobic, the froth becomes unstable. And SIBX will be making them more hydrophobic than SEX. Here we're
talking about the CMC. And it's used two CMC. 金黄药，这个异丁金黄药和金黄药的一个作用就是说，它 就是氢，或者是如果它松水性太高，它的这个泡沫的稳定性也会下降；或者松水性不够的话，它的泡沫的稳定性也是不够。然后就是如果是最佳的一个泡沫稳定性最佳的一个状态，就是这个矿物的松水性是一个适应的最终的一个状态。
Belinda is going to give a talk on measuring heat of immersion in a microcalorimeter. And I think Belinda may be able to show us, we have found the method to determine the actual critical point at which the hydrophobicity is at an optimum using microcalorimeter. Correct, Belinda? Sort of.
Yes, we didn't use it for the froth yet, but we can.
So we think we can now tell you what hydrophobicity best we have. But we'll wait for tomorrow. Right, and so getting close to the end here, then this is now the effect of ions in the water on gangue behavior. So here, this is a simple story. Here we are looking at, again, mass, but this is the mass of gangue recovered at the point where you've got 180 grams of water. So you know, you've got a solid water recovery. So we take 180 and we draw a vertical line there, that's the amount of gangue that we put in against raw dosage. So what we've got here is water of different ionic strengths. This, the orange line here, or yellow line, is high ionic strength water, very hard water. This is tap water, which is relatively softer water. And so what we do in our water research, by the way, we have a recipe which Anglo-American developed to represent water which is typical of their flotation plant. So I think it's actually a good way to study water because we can always compare water of the same ionic strength. It consists of a whole lot of ions, calcium, magnesium, sodium, potassium, sulfates, carbonates, nitrates, and we have a particular ionic strength. But all of the research we do is done at a fixed ionic strength. And I think that turned out to be very valuable because to use deionized water is of no relevance to industry. And if you look at all different types of water on the plant, it's all different. So you've got a fixed quality of water that we always use in our flotation experiments. And what you can see here is that as you get higher ionic strengths, you get quite a lot less, much less gain recovered. Now, Belinda made a point this morning, so far, and this research is part of a consortium of, I don't know, 15 different groups around Europe, we're part of a European Union consortium. So far, it looks like the dirtier your water gets is no problem. You can keep on recycling water many, many times before it starts negatively affecting your performance. So far, maybe we should wait until the screw is finally written. But so take home message here is that as your water gets harder or higher on its strength, the depressant is more efficient.
Mm-hmm. 这个效果的影响，我们用了三种不同的水，一种是红，最上面红色这个是这个自来水，然后中间是模仿湖面的那种人工的水，然后第三种是这个最底下这个黄色的线是一种离子强度非常高的一种水，我发现离子强度越高，对这个抑制效果是越好的，就是对体积的抑制效果。另外就是为了保证这个实验效果的一致，他们就使用就是完全离子强度完全一致的这种水好进行实验。另外就是在实验中发现，就是离子强度越再高，也不会影响这个工业活水，还是可以回来继续进行的。刚刚我们这过这个不是矿热级活水，他们这个就是盐水是一直回用的。
Obviously, by the way, you can see when you're adding at 500 grams per ton, in this example, you have no floating gangue reporting. In other words, you have depressed all the floating gangue. So it makes no difference what the quality of your water is.
when you're adding lower dosages, it does make a difference. But ultimately, 500 grams per ton, the quality of the water may not matter. Okay. Now, well, this is just for interest sake. Copper sulfate is widely used as a modifier in flotation, especially for sulfide. We all know the story of copper sulfate, or sphalerite, for example. It promotes the recovery. I mean, that's another story I'm not going to dwell on. But what this graph is showing is that, let me just make the point, that the solid lines represent the amount of gangue recovered when you've got copper sulfate presence. And the dotted lines of the same color represent the amount recovered when you've got no copper sulfate presence. So the story here is that the presence of copper sulfate results in more protein gangue being recovered. So copper sulfate is working against you because you put your depressant in, but you've also got copper sulfate because you're treating a base metal sulfide tank. And we know copper sulfate is used all over the world to promote the recovery of sulfides. But the copper sulfate results in more gangue being recovered. And so why is that? I'll show in the next slide why. But the point of this slide is that the presence of copper sulfate works against the depressants. It promotes the recovery of the protein gangue.
就是这个硫化铜对方活化作用，就是实现就是表示加入硫化铜的这个矿石，实现就是没有加入硫化铜。然后对比这个实现的出现，发现就是同一个颜色实现的在均线上，就是说这个硫化铜里面的铜离子还是对这个就是这个半石矿的地质起一个反作用，就是说它们活化的作用。
So again, just to emphasize the point, you are an operator. You are an operator on a plant. You put your depressant in, you're a very good operator. You get a bonus because you depress the gangue. You put copper sulfate in, you lose your bonus because now there's more gangue recovery. And also, because your depressant you put in, your froth is less stable, so now you've got to balance frother, depressant, and copper sulfate. There's got to be an optimum somewhere. So you can't just look at one reagent on its own. You have to look at what's happening in the mixture.
就是对泡沫影响，除了这种抑制起泡剂之外，还有就是从另一个部分，就是不能单独看它的其中某个作用，应该说整个能够有效果。
Right. So what is happening? Well, if you are operating a PGM flotation plant, you're operating at about a pH of 9. And if you look at the speciation diagram of copper, and speciation diagrams are critical in flotation research, you will see at pH 9, copper exists as CuOH2 solid. It's copper hydroxide solid that you form in that pulp. And that means that in fact the copper sulfide, the copper hydroxide, is precipitating somewhere. Okay, so that's the species that you've got present. I don't want to take too long, but speciation diagrams are of critical importance in flotation studies. Let me go to the next slide before we worry. So that was a fantastic slide. This is using toxins. I don't know if you use toxins at all, time of flight, secondary ion mass spectroscopy. So this is toxins, and what we see here, these are three pyroxene particles. And pyroxene particles, of course, have got magnesium and silicon, and that's why they match so carefully, so well in that. And here we're looking at copper. We've added copper sulfate to this, and you can see that the copper, this is copper, matches exactly the pyroxene particles. And so this is a fantastic example to show that the copper has activated the pyroxene. So the copper inadvertently activates the gangue, making it report to the concentrate. So if copper sulfate can activate sulfide minerals like sphalerite, well-known story, we know that, but it can also activate the gangue particles. So these pyroxene particles, the xanthate comes along and the xanthate says, gee, that looks good. All these copies are going to absorb on there and it floats. So that is why the copper, and this copper, by the way, is CuOH2 solid from the speciation ligand. It's precipitated up on the pyroxene. The xanthate comes along, sees it as a chalcopyrite body, absorbs on it, makes it hydrophobic, and the gangue reports to the concentrate. Let me leave the slide. So the final slide is about chromite. I mentioned at the beginning, we don't like chromite in the concentrate because it creates problems downstream. So we want to depress the chromite. Now, we have shown in other work that pure chromite cannot be depressed by a depressor. There's no interaction between CMC and chromite. If chromite reports to the concentrate, it's because it entrained. And so this work is from a column flotation cell, a very busy slide. But let me just quick, this is the chromite recovered, percentage chromite. And here we've got different parameters. We've got frostbite, depressant dosage, and air rate. Let me just start here. Effective depressant dosage. This is when you've got everything the same, but this is no depressant, and this is depressant. And hold on a second, this is funny because I've just said chromite cannot be depressed. But you can see, this is where the froth height is 60 centimeters and the air rate is 1.5 centimeters per second. No depressant, depressant. The depressant has reduced the recovery of chromite. That's impossible. But what is happening now is the famous story of talc rimming. The talc has rimmed the chromite particles, making them hydrophobic, and the only way to depress them, to stop them reporting, is to use a depressant. So the only reason why depressant is doing a job here is because the chromite has got talc rimmed. The second way to depress chromite is frostbite. Remember I said right at the beginning, you can only change in a flotation cell air rate, frostbite, and reagent type and dosage. Here we see froth height. In the first instance, we have a froth height of 5 centimeters, and here we have a froth height of 30 centimeters and 60 centimeters. This is a column flotation cell, and you can see froth height reduces the recovery because chromite is recovered by entrainment. And the way to manage entrainment is to increase froth height. So the particles start moving up the froth and then they fall back in. So the story here is that managing the chromite of the gangue is best done by using froth height as far as you can, and if some depression will actually do a good job. So, yeah.
And that is that, because of the tech, because of the tech,
And this is to do with fossil. If you've got a, if you've got a very low fossil, about 5 centimeters, you recover a lot of chroma. If you increase the fossil, you reduce the recovery of chroma. I just want to make a comment about the talc ribbing. There's a lady from Kunming asked a question this morning. I never knew about talc ribbing until a few years ago when Megan Becker told us about it. If I'd known then what I know now, I think it explains a lot of strange observations that we can't understand why chromite is being depressed. And so this talc ribbing in minerality seems to be such an important minerality to be able to understand some strange behavior. For the PET scan. From the PET scan that we get the top remaining information. And as Belinda said this morning, I think you need to be a skilled operator of PET scan to pick it up.
I think the X-rays might be a more for looking into core samples and things like that, whereas the PET scan and MLA looks at the surface of the
particle. Yeah, the tomography is more of a bulk analysis. Okay, so I think that brings me to the end. Let me just quickly wrap it up. The point of this talk is that one of the most important challenges in a flotation plant is to control the amount of gangue. Grade control, that's the new word today. Everybody's talking about grade control. CMC in Guam, widely used. In China, CMC, in South Africa, CMC. We don't do any more work on Guam, do we? The point of the third bullet is just to note, once you put your depressant in, you restrict affected the behavior of the froth. Not only for fresh particles, but the froth has changed its characteristics. I don't think all of our students are doing these days, but a lot of students in our center, everybody got a cell phone, and they take photographs of the froth during their research experiments. So later on, you can look at the pictures and start seeing how the froth is changing in different, and with cell phones today, you can take lovely photographs pretty quickly. Then we've spoken about high ionic strengths, actually a good thing. We've spoken about SIBS and the whole story about hydrophobicity. And we've spoken about chromite, and the final story is that care must be taken to balance the amount of collector, frother, and the present used so as to optimize recoveries and grades. So it's not just one story about depressions. It's depressions, frothers, collectors, and even modified by copper. So it's a complex mixture of a whole lot of parameters.
另外就是高强度的原因，就粘水强度特别高的话，其实是，所以一直在我是有一个促进作用，另外就是一定是防药相比较，防药的话会有一个。
增大矿种的这个就是各种但是它会影响到这个，因为它韧性太高，反而会影响到矿脉的稳定性，情况特别严重。最后一个就是说，抑制剂呢，是可以降低个体矿的回收率的，但是但是这个纯的这个慢时矿还是会，最后一条是，
对，最后就是说，在真正的实践里，一定要平衡好。
Okay, it's a picture of our university. We have down somewhere, that's Table Mountain. This is the other side of Table Mountain. So, if you want to see the table, go to the other side. So, on the other side, you see that famous picture of the table. This is the northern part. So normally at the end of a talk, you must show acknowledgement. So I would like to acknowledge Dr. Van, who's been fantastic. Now, we've got one more talk for the day, and I think we should take a few minutes to stretch our legs, to give Dr. Van a few moments to lubricate and
throat,
and then Belinda is on this. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Maybe can be a good have a rest.
Maybe
some rest then you can go to
5 minutes.
是张俊东博士，现在美国休斯顿。15年来，我协助国内科研人员润色和发表 SCI 论文上万篇，解决论文发表过程中遇到的各种问题。请来参加我讲授的 SCI 论文切磋和发表课程。 是张俊东博士，现在美国波士顿。15年来，我协助国内科研人员润色和发表 SCI 论文上万篇，解决论文发表过程中遇到的各种问题。请来参加我讲授的 SCI 论文切磋和发表课程。是张俊东博士，现在美国波士顿。15年来，我协助国内科研人员润色和发表 SCI 论文上万篇，解决论文发表过程中遇到的各种问题。请来参加我讲授的 SCI 论文切磋和发表课程。是张俊东博士，现在美国波士顿。15年来，我协助国内科研人员润色和发表 SCI 论文上万篇，解决论文发表过程中遇到的各种问题。请来参加我讲授的 SCI 论文切磋和发表课程。
For how they go about improving flotation performance. So just to give you a refresher, if you've forgotten, these are mostly the kinds of collectors that I'm going to be talking about. The xanthates, the dithiophosphates, and the dithiophosphates. Just so that you can see what they look like, what I'm going to be talking about. Okay, so maybe you see that you know that So they all have these two sulfurs in the head group. What differs, these two have the carbon, and what differs is the element that they are attached to over there.
这两个结构唯一的区别就是一个是在碳的这个阿尔法位是一个氧原子，然后硫的氨基酸酸酯的话在这个羰基的阿尔法位是一个氮原子。
So this is just a summary from the literature on what has been observed in some of the studies that have been done. And so I'm going to go through it quite quickly. It's that improved rates and recoveries. We get more even coverage of the collector. Improved rates and recovery again. Preferential DTP absorption. And improved recovery. So you can see in a lot of different studies, you find these improved rates and recoveries and improved surface coverage.
这个如下不所示呢，这些题目呢，都是以前发表的出版的一些关于不同这个关于黄药和这个黑药之间的一些相互作用的一些研究的报道。
The previous ones was for xanthate-DTP mixtures. These are for xanthate-DTC mixtures. And again, it's mostly the same sort of thing, improvements in rate and recovery. But we need to remember that when there is no improvement, those papers usually don't get published. So we have seen in our labs that collector mixtures don't always result in improvements in rates and recoveries, but sometimes they do.
协同作用的这个一些报告，但是这些报告仅仅是没有发表，然后仅仅是在我们的网站上面挂出，然后有的时候看到有的时候没有。So
as I said, the mechanisms that have been suggested for why they produce improvements in rates and recovery have been not proven and not particularly scientific. So one of them says that there are collector specific sites on the mineral surface. So there will be one site that is more oxidized and maybe that will be good for a DTE, for a Z
这个目前关于这个补充剂与这个矿物表面作用的这个机理呢，目前一个概念就是这个特定位点呢，就比如说按这个图来说，如图所示呢。有的地方被氧化了，但是没关系。
不是，里面有是用不要求的。
Another theory says that it forms that the collective mixture forms binary complexes in the solution.And then that they precipitate like that onto the mineral surface. Binary, two together. So one collector, the other collector, in solution. And there's another theory that says that you get one layer of chemisorbed species on the bottom, and that this provides a surface for the dimers, the disanthogen, to form on top of.
还有一种就是覆盖的这种假说，就是由这个由硫单基羧酸酯首先吸附在这个。矿物的表面，然后再就是双黄药的话，再继续跟这个矿表面的。
Then there's another theory that I want to discuss that I like because it seems a little bit more scientific to me, proposed by Norm Lotter.And what he proposed is that you rank your mineral types based on their semiconductor, whether they're an N-type or a P-type semiconductor. So what is an N-type and a P-type semiconductor? N-types are mostly free electrons. So if you look here, this is the band structure for an N-type.Mostly free electrons and a slightly negative surface. Whereas the P type, P for positive, it has a slightly more positive surface. Should I stop there so you can just explain that?
这个 Lotter 然后提出了这个N 型和 P 型的这个硫化这个把。这个矿表面可以作为一个半导体，然后他提出了这个 N 型和 P 型的这个假说，然后 N 型的话，大部分是这个有可以自由活跃的这个电子，然后 P 型的话，主要是由这个空壳的可能是带有一些正电荷的空壳去有这样的特征，带有正电荷的物质。
So the important part is that one has a slightly negative surface.The other one has a slightly positive surface, which means that the negative charge needs the uncharged diphthylate in order to absorb, whereas the slightly positive surface needs the negatively charged phthalate to absorb. So this one's negative. If there was a negative phthalate, it would repel each other.It needs the neutral diphthylate to absorb.
这个
双黄药
是一个中性的，然后这个 N 型和 P 型呢，它的主要的区别就是在于电荷正负性的这个区别。如果是带有正电荷的这种矿物表面，它就容易和这个带有负电子的。作为一个阴离子的这种捕捉剂，容易去结合，而这个 它容易与就是电中性的这种表面共振。
中性的容易吸附双环氧，而且这个 P A 型的容易吸附双环氧 ，P 型的容易吸附氧。
So
the short explanation for that is that some minerals need the dimer, the diphthalate. Are you following me when I say dimer? This one, rather than this one. This is the dimer. It's two xanthate molecules which have oxidized and come together. This one is just one xanthate molecule on its own. So, some minerals need the dimer, and some minerals need the single xanthate. And it's the pulp pH that dictates whether you have this one or this one.
就是由这个矿浆的 pH 去反映了究竟是用由这个羟基去结合的呢，还是由这个是由黄药去是由是由黄药还是由双黄药去结合去做这个官能同结合。
因为这电位可以，这黄药变成双黄药可以靠电位啊变化电位。你变成一个容易生成双黄药的电位，电位高就容易双黄药，那么这个你要想让它生成黄药，电位高一点。
So if you look at the pH-pH diagram for butyl xanthate and ethyl DTP, you can see that the butyl xanthate exists in this area up to about 150 millivolts, and above that it exists as the dimer, as this diazanthogen, whereas in this region here, you get the diazanthogen and you also get the ethyl DTP.
这个图反映的就是冰黄药和这个以及黑药的这样一个协同的关系。纵轴是这个电位的 pH 电位的这个由纵轴可以看到呢，如果是在第一个区域当中呢，就是如果是高于 C B 和 C 的这条线，就是黄药就会变成这个双黄药，然后但是黑药依然是没有形成二聚体。
So if you have a group of minerals in your ore that need both the dimer and the xanthate ion, then you should be working in this region here, because here you can have the dimer and you can have the ion as well. So if you have minerals that need both, you should be working in this pH and pH range.
如果是需要用黄药的二聚体去起作用的，应该把 pH 值和 EH 值调在教授所指的这个范围内，就可以获得所想达到的效果。
I'm gonna skip this one. The explanation is too complicated. Right.I'm going to show you some examples now from our laboratory. And so, first of all, we looked in our laboratory at the effect of collected mixtures on galena in a microflotation cell. So.
这个是混合补充混合补充剂的这个光纤矿的作用的一个影响。
So, some collectors are known to act as frothers, and so we decided to use a microflotation cell so that you can decouple the froth phase from the pulp phase. The microflotation cell has no froth, it is only a pulp phase. So we wanted to focus on the pulp phase.
由于有一些这个捕捉剂嘛，它的同时也兼有这个催化剂的功效，它可以催化。因此为了我们为了将这个研究的注意力嘛集中在这个捕捉剂的捕捉性的之上，我们设计了这个复选管去进行复选实验，目的是为了消除上述的这个捕捉剂的气泡性影响，只关注捕捉剂捕捉性的影响。
So in this case, we were using mixtures of xanthate and DCP. So in this case, it's the ethyl xanthate and the ethyl DCP. And what you can see is that this line here is with no collector. These are the single collectors. And then when you make a mixture, you get improvements in rate and recovery for a 90%, 10% mixture, or a 10%, 90% mixture.
这个复选实验呢是用这个乙基黄药和乙基黑药去进行的，红线所指的这条线呢是没有捕捉剂加入时候的，然后再往上是只使用了单一的捕捉剂，而最上边这个复选回收率放松后非常回收率比较高的这样的线呢就是使用了混合的捕捉剂进行使用。
So that is for the ethyl chainase. Then we looked at the same xanthate and DCP, but for the isobutyl chain links. And what we see now is that there is no effect of using mixtures. The isobutyl xanthate is always the best collector when you use the longer chain links. So no benefit to using collector mixtures.
这一组最主要的目的是说明增强链条好像对于这个因为是为了研究两种不同基团对于这个协同作用对于这个矿物的研究而就是它这一个主要是体现了改变这个链条的话对于这个就是不符合这个规律。改变这个链条的话是不符合同一组数的这个规律。
In this case, we use xanthase and DCC, and again, you can see that this is with no collector. These are the single collectors, and when you make a mixture, that's 90% xanthase, 10% DCC.You get this very big increase in rate and recovery.
然后你就是大家看一下那个图，看那个差额就明显能够看到，当你是90:10的时候，最开始乙基黄药比那个 DTD， 所以乙基黄药往上是转链的，然后转链和成链的，然后发生一个协同作用，然后这个协同作用导致它的回收率上升非常快，就是这样。然后下边的那个蓝色线呢？软色线的话，它就是那个 LFD， 它的回收率就没有那么高了，所以说你必须要协同的时候，它能完成好效果。
Again, when we increase the chain length, now we're using isobutyl. Again, you don't see any benefits of using mixtures. The isobutyl xanthate always gives you the best performance.
就是说你这个混合之后的话，才能得到，就是说，它这儿贴的两个就是蓝色那条线嘛，就是说，当你对它的那个链长，不增加链长的时候，它效果反而非常好，而且总是表现的非常好。但是呢，当你把它链长改变的时候呢，它就会出现变化，而且会降低。但是它也有一定效果，但是没有混合的那么好。OK。
So what did we find from this study? Well, we found that when you use the short chain lengths, then you got big improvements in recovery, but the longer chain lengths still remain better collected than the shorter chain lengths.
就是说他单用药效果就是最好了，然后他本面的总的起球效果就是比较差，用这个表达是这个意思。OK。
So now what we did was we did more or less the same thing, but we introduced a frog phase. So we did this in a batch flotation cell rather than in a micro flotation cell.
他们之前用的是那个微泡虎，就是微泡虎的管控的负电，就是可以渐渐的，它就不用微泡虎，因为当时那个没有泡沫，就是泡沫因为看不见嘛，而这儿呢就加入了泡沫，用了flotation。OK。
We did the test with galena and with pyrite, and what we see here is that these are all just single collectors. Single collectors for galena, single collectors for pyrite. And in this case, the ethyl VTP was the best collector for galena, but it was the worst for pyrite. On the other hand, SIBX was the best collector for pyrite, whereas it was not so good for galena.
Just a comment, Professor Weissman was talking earlier about pyrite depression. I forget what the whole recording was.
Yeah.
Wasn't that sort of hit the SEDTP? It's quite a good predictor for reasonable separation of galena and pyrite.
At this pH, yes. Yeah. So, looking at 89% galena with only 33% pyrite. So, the point of this slide is that the best collector for galena is the worst collector for pyrite, which makes it good for separation. Now we use mixtures, and again, we see that what is best for galena, 92% recovery for galena, you get a fairly poor pyrite recovery, and what was best for pyrite, it's not bad, but it's mineral specific. The collected types are specific for certain minerals.
你使用有混合辅助剂在不同比例下，然后进行荒间矿的这个黄金矿的时候，然后得到的时候发现，像当你的那个黄金矿就是在10:90的时候，然后那个黄金矿的回收率达到92.2%，那个黄铁矿达到平均利息，其实这体现是一种选择性。然后第一个是，当它是单比例的时候的话，它就是说对于那个黄铁矿的处理上的这个，而对烧金矿的时候用户很高。
So the question was the mixture better than the single collector? And so what we did was if you look at this, for example, 90% xanthate with 10% ETP. When we used the single collector, these are the recoveries that we got. If you calculate what the recovery should be by weighting these 90 times that plus 10 times that, you get that value there. Okay?
题，就是说你当工作其实是一个关系嘛，就是说你当时用两个补充剂，当补充剂补充的时候，你就把它70%引导到80%，它的意思是你混合之后，我把它单独来算，我单独算之后再把它加权，加权之后得到的值呢，显然比那个混合的要小，意思是里面就存在交互关系，它交互关系呢会提高你的补选效率，所以说这个交互关系在里面是有助于补选的，换句话说就是表达说一定存在交互关系。
So that was what we calculated the recovery should have been if you just used that much of the single collectors, but that is what the actual recovery was when we used the mixtures. So you can see that there is evidence that the mixtures are better than what the single collectors would be on their own.
我通过理论计算，然后单个的得到的结果是7.3，但是我实际上我得到的结果，我把它们混合，就为了理论计算，就是说我单独算像 A 单独算 B， 然后把 A 加 B 的部分加在一起，然后呢我混合，但是我做了实验，实验表明我做的比 A 加 B 更好。啊，对，就是。
And so in all these cases here, the actual recovery was better.Than the calculated recovery. And what that showed, we have these collectors which are strong collectors. These ones are weaker. When we use strong and weak collectors together, these ones, they produce synergistic effects. When we use strong together, they produce antagonistic effects. You know those words?
What does the antagonistic
mean? It means it's worse than the predictor.
就是说，这个单词我也不能翻译了。就是说，它的意思是强的辅助剂和弱的辅助剂两个在一起的时候呢，对，就有协同作用、协同效应。但是呢，你和强的辅助剂联合在一起的时候呢，产生的就是一个更糟糕的结果。这儿的强是指常见，通常是常见的。
So just a summary of those findings was that the different collectors and collected mixtures produced different effects on galena and pyrite. The best collector for galena was the worst for pyrite. The predicted weighted recoveries of the mixed collectors were less than for single collectors. You can read them. I've said it all already.
就是它前面都已经说过了，这儿只是对前面一个小结啊。总结的话，还是同样的结论，就是说，还是刚才的，以强联手反而变弱，然后呢，强弱联手反而变强。所谓的强是常练辅助性特别好，以及表现好的强，然后弱是表现的辅助性，然后就是说你强弱联手的时候会达到更好效果，然后强强联手的就变强变差，然后就是前面是他们直接方法，通过预测和。有那个计算所谓的 weighted recovery， 其实就是一个权重，其实是它计算出来的一个结果，计算出来结果和预测结果均表明存在协同作用。然后我下班了，就是也就是前面的我不。
One more look at different collector interactions, and this is for a copper nickel ore. So now we move from looking at single minerals in microflotation, single minerals in batch flotation, and now we're looking at proper ore. So the approach was that we used 50% SIBX, 50% ethyl xanthate, and we mixed it with diphosphate, either dithiocarbonate or diphosphate. Self-explanatory. So the first thing to note, and remember that before I said that sometimes the DTP has frothy lighting effects. So in this case, the blue in this graph is the water recovery. And for most of the other collectors, the water recovery is similar. And just for DTP, you get a much higher water recovery. So it shows that it has some fronting effects.
And if we look at some of the grain and recovery results, this is for the Zanthate and the DTP mixture. This is the grade, and we're looking at here, so this is grade recovery, and this is the percent DTP in the mixture. So this is no DTP, this is 100% DTP, and you're increasing the DTP concentration as you go on. And so you can see that for, what was it? The best grade was at 70% DTP, 30% xanthate. The best recovery was at 30% DTP and 70% xanthate.
刚刚图的解释都在那个六七分上讲，六七分上讲，就是两句话，六七分上讲，不管错，但一个表现最好的，也就是说当这个比例是73%的时候，然后对于那个，就是77比3，就是说73和37各自说明了，在该点处，它对一个字对那个对边小的对边，那一个一个最好，一个是最差，而对于那个百分百就非常，
And then looking at the DTC mixtures, which have disappeared. So looking at the DTC mixtures, again, you see that the mixture was better than the pure collector, and you got the best at 90% xanthate with 10% DTP. So showing again that collector mixtures can be good for flotation performance.
这就是说，它就是下边那个坐标是DTC的一个百分比，就是说你的百分比，其实还是不用标明，就是比例是第一次增加的，然后只有在那个10%左右的时候的话，达到效果。对于那个红色那条线的话，它就说，你当你是90%左右的时候，你的效果是最好的。
So now looking at all those three studies together, we could see that there was some differences between them. First of all, the microflotation cell showed big differences in recoveries for collector mixtures, which we didn't see in the batch flotation cell. And this is probably something to do with the amount of energy input that goes into the two different cells. The batch flotation cell has an impeller, it has a higher energy input. The microflotation cell is it's just a stream of bubbles. It's a very low energy
environment. 而使用风险度的时候的话，就比较小，所以说这个原因会解为可能是因为凝视度的能量差异，也就是说一个你采用凝视度大的泡沫，凝视度大的泡沫，然后是可见的泡沫，一个是不可见的泡沫，这两个的区别，就是能量差异。
We saw that it appears that a strong collector and a weak collector is
does better than a strong collector and a strong collector together. And then finally, I didn't mention, but we were using very low dosages in all of these tests. So it appears that you can use low dosages of mixtures to improve your flotation performance. You're not finished yet. There's more. So that was collector-collector. Now we're going to look at collector-proper interactions, right? And in particular, not just any collector, but we're going to look at, we all finished. It's okay. Okay, so we're going to look at the phosphate and proper interactions. So we know that the phosphate is a commonly used salt collector for sulfide and PGM ores. It's used to selectively recover copper in copper lead zinc ores. It's a poor collector of galena. It's also a poor collector of iron sulfides. And in South Africa, we often use it in collector mixtures with a xanthate for floating sulfides and PGM ores. So if we take a look at the different types of collectors from the diphthyl phosphate, the xanthate, the diphthyl carbamate, what is the difference between these collectors? Well, the diphthyl phosphate has these two oxygen atoms over here. So they are electronegative and they pull electron density away from these sulfur atoms over here.
就是说这个飞将嘛，飞将旁边这两个氧，这两个氧它是一个吸电子，所谓的叫，就是说几百万我要这个电，电，电，它会将整个整个电子，就是说这个磷这边这个气场的整个电子，它会上它，这样就使得油和油这边的电子成为少电。Whereas
for diphthyl carbamate, it's got a nitrogen atom over here, and it's more electropositive, you know. That word electropositive, it pushes electron density towards the sulfur atoms, and the result of this is that it makes DTC a much stronger collector than the PTP.
So
Do we agree?
Which one is stronger? First one or last
one? No, this one is stronger because these sulfur orbitals are bigger. Those sulfur orbitals are smaller. This one's pulling electron density away. This one's pushing electron density in. I think it's lost in translation. Okay, so this one's stronger, this one's weaker. Okay. Also, we're working at, mostly we work at basic pH, so high pH, which means that our mineral surface is coated with oxides, and that makes it difficult for the collector to absorb. Mostly we work at basic pH. So there is agreement in the literature that the absorption of DGP is pH, EH, and mineral dependent. It's showing it here. There are many cases where DTP actually does not absorb on the mineral surface at all. And yet, even when it does not absorb, you still get large increases in recovery that are observed.
它的锡布锡布量，但是跟锡控的都是有pH和EH所区分的。然后呢，对于你很多情况下的话，那个DGP，指标上，标上就说很多例子都表现，在比较高的pH，pH表现下的话，那个锡布锡布量就稀释了。然后第三条呢，就是说，基于预期，锡布的控表面的话，就是说回收率依然不增加。至于这是不是真实的影响，还不清楚。
So our question for this project became, if DTP is not absorbing on the mineral surface, how does it improve flotation recovery? There have not been very many previous collector-frother interaction studies. This is a summary of some of them. I'm not going to go through them now, but the point, there have been very few collector-frother interactions in the literature. So this is what we did in the study. This was our experimental method. First, we looked at the bubble particle attachment, and we used the microflotation cell, and what we wanted to we used these different collectors here, ATP and xanthate, with all these different frothers. We used two minerals, galena and pyrite, two pHs, and we used the collector dosage that covered half of the available surface area. So, in order to take out the effect of different bubble sizes and any hydrodynamic effects, we also use the automated contact time apparatus that measures the bubble particle attachment probability. Are you familiar with the bubble particle attachment probability?
Yes.
So that was bubble particle attachment. Now we look at what's going on at the air-water interface. So we used bubble pressure tensiometry, and we measured the surface tension. And because surface tension is not very, it's not very sensitive in when it comes to frothers, we also use bubble size. We measure the bubble size. So surface tension and bubble size.
So,
results. What happened when we did this work? So, firstly, looking at the microflotation results, and what we see is that. What we see is that when we have no reagents or any of the single reagents, so this is DTP on its own, xanthate on its own, xanthate with frother, they all have the same effect. But what happens when you add frother to the DTP, you get this big increase in recovery like this. So that was for pyrrhotic pH 9. Then if we look at pyrrhotic pH 4, we see again the same thing, that we get this increase in recovery when the frother is added to the BTP. It doesn't have the same effect when you add frother to xanthate, but only when you add frother to BTP. And let me just carry on. If that's pyrite recovery at pH 4, this is galena recovery at pH 4, the same thing as well. So what these previous two graphs show is that this increase in recovery when DTP is added to frother is independent of the pH, because it happened with pH 4 and 9, and it's also independent of the mineral type, because it happened for both galena and para. 就是说，把DTP和这个氢气泡剂，我们的一起的话，在不同的这个限制和不同的温度的状况都会出现这种回收的现象。还是说明它的它的氢气泡剂。And then we wanted to see whether it was just the kind of frother that we were using, so we used various different kinds of frother. And we found that it was also independent of frother type. You always got this increase in recovery when you use all different kinds of frother with BTP. So So then we wanted to see was, well, is the DTP absorbing onto the mineral surface? So this is the amount of collector that was absorbed. This is for the xanthate. So of what was added, 100% of the xanthate absorbed onto galena and onto pyrite, whether frother was present or not, 100% absorbed. However, no DTP absorbed onto galena, and only about 30% of what we added absorbed onto pyrite.
就是说，对，乙基黄药来说，它，单独添加在，矿铅矿和矿铁矿里面的吸附都很高，然后它加了，就是乙基黄药加了几矿基以后，它们在，矿铅矿和乙基黄铁矿上面的吸附也很高，但是对 SDPP
或者 SDPP 加入，几矿基以后，它们在这个矿铅矿和矿铁矿上面的吸附都很低，30%。 Then the question was, well, if it's not absorbing on the mineral surface, is it absorbing at the air-liquid interface? So we measured the surface tension here as a function of the surfactant concentration. There's no change in the surface tension for xanthate. There is a change in the surface tension when you add DTP. But not as much as when you add frother, and this is DTP and frother together.
就是说这个乙基黄药它的表面张力是下降的，但是FDPP它会改变这个，它会使这个表面张力下降，但是它的在重要程度远远是加上主矿基或者是其他结合SDPP联合使用。
Then we measured the critical coalescence concentration. We heard of critical coalescence concentration. That is how the bubble diameter reduces as a function of the frother concentration. And what we found was that DTP does reduce the bubble size as a function of the DTP concentration, but again, not as much as for the hexanol. So the point here was the DTP is slightly surface active. It does absorb at the air-liquid interface, but there was no synergistic effect between the frother and the DTP.
就是说，其实那个DTP是具有表面活性的成型，但是它的起泡率之间是没有结合作用。Finally,
we look at the bubble particle attachment probability, and we can see firstly, and alongside that, we look at the microflotation recoveries. So we can see that for the bubble particle attachment probability, it says the same thing as what we've been seeing all along, is that you have a much greater attachment probability when you have DTP and frother together. So it's saying the same thing as for microflotation. DTP and frother have some synergistic interaction.
就发现这个红色的触状是最高的，说明这个 SDPP 跟这个存在的起泡剂是有一定的作用。
You can see the DTP on its own had no effect. It was the same as for no reagents. And so DTP alone was the same as for no reagents. And xanthate and hexam and frother does not have the same effect as DTP and frother. So what we found was that DTP synergistically improves flotation performance in the presence of a frother. It's not acting as a conventional collector because it does not absorb at the solid-liquid interface. It's more surface active at the air-liquid interface than xanthate. And so what we believe is happening and what the attachment probability studies show is happening is that DTP with frother increases the kinetics of film thinning and that it improves the bubble particle attachment. Right, we're almost there. One last bit to go, and this is the frother interactions, and this is a study where we decouple the subprocesses of froth stability, froth recovery, and entrapment. Okay, so I think you also know that, certainly in South Africa, most of the frothers that are used on site are mixtures. It's not a single frother. There's not a lot of research on frother blends, though. Some studies have shown that it improves flammability, reduces that thing I was talking about, the critical coalescence concentration, improves recovery and grade, and the mechanism is that it attributes the synergistic effects to increased packing. So when you have different kinds of molecules, they can pack better at the air water interface. So this was a previous study done at UCT by our colleague Jenny Hisser. And what was found here was what we're looking at, this is nickel recovery and nickel grade. And these are single collectors over here, and these are mixtures over here. 40%
of a polyglycol, 10% of an alcohol. And what's interesting is that both the recovery and the grade increases when you use the mixture of two brothers together, which is very unusual. You would either expect the recovery to increase, grade to decrease, increase the recovery to decrease. So we decided to do a follow-up study on the previous study, and what we wanted to do was decouple all the different sub-processes that are involved in flotation. And so we wanted to look at the froth recovery, the froth stability, the entrainment, and the grain.
就是说他们这边到底是什么作用，所以要多混合的情况比较，就是什么作用，他们就做了一些，这个跟他来做这个单一复合实验，就包括这个单一反常，包括这个泡沫的回收率，泡沫的平行，夹带，还有它的平板。These
are the different kinds of frothers that we used. We used some like that. So PGM 700 mineral UT2. You've seen pictures of the mineralogy of this presentations. It's mostly chromite, and chromite is very useful for doing entrainment studies, because you can use it as a tracer. It doesn't float. The only way it gets into the concentrate is by entrainment. So this is how we measured the froth recovery. We used a specialized little cell. It was the small bench scale flotation column. It has three different froth heights that you can use. And we used this method of Vera et al., where you can determine the froth recovery by determining the rate constant at three different froth heights. This is how we measure froth stability. I showed you this column earlier. All it is, it has a glass sprit at the bottom. You bubble air through your pulp and you measure the froth height as a function of time. You measure the maximum froth height, and from that you get the froth stability, which is the maximum froth height divided by the superficial gas velocity.
This is the 边这个柱子呢，就会这个泡沫柱就会从这个柱子往上升到一定的高度，然后这个泡沫的这个神经他们就算这个泡沫的高度和这个时间的变化。
So this is the recovery and grade that we got. So for the higher molecular weight, these are the pure collectors. These are the blends with an alcohol. So you can see that for the 45 and 75, these are higher molecular weight frothers. You got an increase in recovery. And either the same grade or an increase in the grade when you, so an increase in recovery and an increase in grade when you use the blend.
这个图的分两部分，一部分就是说它用纯的这种情况下的时候，这个前面两种数据就是 TPC 425和TPC 725的话，它的这个回收率要比第二个要低。
It wasn't the same for the lower molecular weight. The recovery actually went down and the grade went up, which is what you would expect. We're not sure why it's not the same for the lower molecular weight.
就是对第一个 TPC 192的话不一样，它是使用纯的这种情况下的时候，它的回收率
This is what happens to the froth stability. So on this axis is the froth stability, and you can see that when you have a blend, this is the single collector. This is the blend. You get an increase in froth stability each time, so you always get an increase in froth stability from the blend.
就是说这个混合的起泡剂，得到这个泡沫的形式，用单一的起泡剂它的稳定性更好。
This is just a little interesting extra. We tested these frothers in two phases, meaning just the frother in water with air, and then in three phases, that means with solids present as well. And what we found was differences in the trends. So in two phases, you got an increase in froth stability from this to this to this, whereas in three phases, it went through a maximum like that. So this was just, it was interesting for us, and we decided we must always test frothers in the presence of solids.
这是一个两项和三项的这个泡沫稳定性的对比，就是前面这个两项呢，就是只有是气泡和液体的地方，它的性能就是就是逐渐升高的这种曲线，然后后面的是三项就是加了曲线不同的这个泡沫稳定性的话，就不是逐渐升高的趋势，只会先上。
Now we come, so we've looked at recovery and grade, we've looked at froth stability, now we want to look at entrainment. How does the frother blend affect entrainment? So, firstly, how do we find entrainment? We plot your chromite recovery, because chromite is your tracer. It only gets there by entrainment. Chromite versus water recovery. The slope of that line is your entrainability, the amount of entrained material per unit water.
这个是关于那个钾钙的一个计算，就是说那个总的水的回收率，还有一个 一定部分呢是回收的一个比例，根据这个来算这个材料。
And so what we found was that the entrainment factor for the blends, these ones here, frothers, that you were getting less entrainment using, which would explain why you get a better grade. So,
通过对夹蛋的计算呢，发现这个混合的起泡剂它的这个就是夹蛋的这个因子啊反而更小，就说明它的夹蛋更少，它是可以回收的，不是更好的。
So we saw that the froth blends can change the froth characteristics. We saw that froth stability increases.And that increased your valuable mineral recovery. But at the same time, your drainage also increases, which reduces your entrainability and which increases your grade. So by decoupling these different sub-processes, we could explain why you got an increase in both recovery and grade. And congratulations, you've made it to the end. Are there any questions? Yes.
It's brief about the question of the grade and the lead using the discharge predictor.
Yes.
How useful is the discharge predictor with the discharge?
Are you asking what depressants we use when we. Okay, so.In those studies, it was a synthetic ore. We made it ourselves. So there was no gangue minerals. And so we didn't need to use any depressant. It was only collector. Sure. Do you think it will affect the
interaction between the distance and the distance?
Oh, that, in my presentation, I showed on the same with the SEX versus the SRBX, and then the froth and the crescent. And I think, you know, we use factorial design methods quite a lot. And so I think if you've got so many variables, probably factorial design is a good way to understand that.
So usually there won't be, as far as I know, there's no direct interaction between the collector and the frother. But what will happen is that sometimes the depressant can depress some of your valuable mineral as well. And so you may get some depression of your valuable minerals when you add the depressant. Another, sure.
When you talk about the discharge, it means that the liquid is very strong, very strong. Then you can't interpret the patient the way strong and not good.
Good question. And so, no, probably the answer at the moment is I don't. It was an observation, and we haven't taken it any further than that. So, without sitting down and giving it some thought,I'm not sure what the answer to your question is.
Okay. I want to ask a question. Belinda made a comment at the beginning that what are the works in flotation in China with on oxides? Do plants feed oxides move mixtures of electrons? and what all the
the amines and fatty acids.
Oh yeah. What do you guys
need? Some challenge to run and
I got some. The microcalorimetry work, which I'm sure Belinda will talk about tomorrow, shows that there's no enthalpy or no heat of absorption observed when you contact with many sulfides.
Wait, we have another question over here. So we haven't done any studies to show that there were some interactions. I can't recall exactly how they went, but what I do remember was it only happened at very high concentration, way above what you would use in a normal plot. So my answer would be that they are probably negligible at the concentrations that we actually use in flotation.
Actually, I did some work on the fourth and the first and I did all this
I think that's an interesting observation, that flotation is so complex, you cannot take the results from one ore type and translate them into another ore type, like oxides, because as Belinda said, all this work is in sulfides. Oxides are totally different system, but you were looking at sulfides.
The ore is sulfide.
Oh, the two places, no. Sulfides. What sulfides were there?
which compares the minimum and the hazard. And I think maybe you change the sequence and you maybe look at the study and the mechanism of the study is the same for a different topic. It's a change of form because of your work.
From country to country also.
Yes, but our result is different from the your proofing is lower because your proofing is lower and surface is high. In fact, that's the study in proofing is not high, the surface is low. But the trend is interesting.
That's interesting. We always have much lower bed. What kind of profile were you using? Okay.
So that's also a mixture, not the just.
Okay, so that must be why, because in when we use the the particles and the particles always where it is in your case, but it seems to empty
same.
We don't, as you will see in one of my other presentations, we are not experts in. We have. But that's an interesting point. Have you looked at reagent interaction? Away, did it? That's very interesting.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Perhaps the how in managing bubble particle attachment processes.
So it's through contact time.
I think my hat is.
So we have an array, and there are six needles. And at the bottom of each needle, there's a bubble. There's a bed of particles. The instrument comes down, and the bubble attaches to the particle bed. It lifts up, and then it gets photographed, and also it actually deposits the particles. It collects the particles. Yes. Oh, you're asking actually the attachment probability. Oh, now you're asking me. I need my student to solve it. Attachment probability was calculated by the number of times that a bubble actually picked up the particle. So if you've got 50 bubbles and only 25 of them picked up particles, that's a 50% attachment probability. I think that's how.
Yeah,
I think that's how.
So exactly, if you've got 50 bubbles and only 25 of them succeed picking up particles, that was a 50% probability that it would pick up particles.
Mm-hmm. No, it was just on whether they picked up particles or not. There's another way that you can do it. You can actually measure just the total mass of particles that were picked up, because you can measure that mass as well. So there are a number of different ways that you can So we don't have this piece of equipment at UCT. My student went to Aalto University in Finland and we used their equipment there. All right. Is that all?
Okay.
We are done. I think just as you walk in.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you also to the Trump.